with me. Akina Valentin is in the back, and it's Scholasticor Zoo is somewhere. There he is. There he is. Stand up, Akina. They are part of the contingent of 20 of us that flew to St. Vincent back in, from July 19 to the 23rd, 2009. So we had an opportunity to see the scenes that were there. And there is Andrea.
Does she know?
May I invite Mr. Celso Castro to the stage? Let's give him a hand.
How'd it go? Hi, how are you? Good.
Hello, Andrea.
Hi. Hi, Jose. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you again. It's been a while.
I know it has, yeah.
Actually, for the benefit of the audience, Andrea and I met Andrea in 1998. And I met Andrea actually through another project that she was working on about the Garifuna. It's called The Garifuna Journey. Right, Andrea?
Right, correct. That was a while ago.
Yeah, and during that time, I was telling Dior the fact that I was traveling for business and I visited Chicago and I visited Andrea's home.
That's right, that's right.
So wow. We go way back.
Yeah, that's true. Pleasure. I'm not at home anymore. I'm now in California.
Okay, times have changed. But yeah. Andrea, it's a pleasure to have you here. We just finished watching your movie. And the audience really enjoyed it. And can you tell us a little bit about how you came up with the idea of creating this movie?
Okay, well, as you mentioned, I made the Garifuna Journey film in Belize, and I was invited to St. Vincent in 2005 for National Heroes Day. And the first national hero of St. Vincent in the Caribbean is Chatoyer, who was the chief Carib at the time of the wars against the British. So anyways, I was invited to show my film to villages around the country, all these small villages. And when I showed the film, people came up to me saying, wow, I have Carib ancestry. And I had no idea that my culture survived overseas in the diaspora. And they were very emotional. They were crying. They were, you know, I was really struck by that. And they were saying, we have no culture. Look at the culture that we lost. So I said, well, you don't have the culture that you see in the film, but you have a culture and you have a story, and your story hasn't been told. So I picked up a camera and I began to shoot at that time in 2005. And then I went all over the country shooting. And then I went back in 2012 I went back several times in 2005, 2006, 2012. And I'm gonna go back in March again. Are you gonna be there at the conference?
I'm taking that as an invitation, sure. But Andrea, one of the things that I find interesting is the fact that you, between the Garifuna Journey and now with Yurumein, you have two of the only documentaries that exist about the exile, and now actually relating it to the current situation, which is very fascinating. But let me ask you, I saw Dr. Kadrin Gill, who I met in 1991, and he went there also with us in 2009. What was your experience working with Dr. Gill?
Well, it's a really interesting story of how I met him, because I was actually sitting in the edit room here in San Francisco. It's a long story, but I'll shorten it. And my editor kept saying, you have to get an interview with Armando and Ashante, the dancers that you saw from the Honduras. So he kept telling me I needed to get an interview with them. So I called Ronnie Figueroa down in Los Angeles, and he happened to be on his way to the airport to pick up Armando and Ashante, who were performing that weekend. So I asked, can I come down and interview him? He said, sure, come on down. And that weekend, I met Dr. Gill. And I was shocked to have met a Carib from Sandy Bay, who's a physician living in Los Angeles and taking care of Garifuna, you know, patients. I mean, it was a remarkable story. And he's so passionate about, you know, his story. And he really wants to bring that back to St. Vincent too, so that he can raise the self-esteem of the people there. It was a wonderful opportunity, and I haven't finished working with him yet. We're still working.
Absolutely. Like I mentioned, I met Dr. Gill in 1991. He was the first Vincentian, actually, that I met. And okay. we have kept the relationship, and you're right about his passion for bringing back the culture. And when we went in 2009, the one thing that I remember was when he said, you know what, this is really the renaissance of the Garifuna culture in St. Vincent. That's how committed he is. But again, going back to St. Vincent, I noticed that you focused on Sandy Bay. Any particular reason?
Well, you know, I have to find certain people within the island who could tell the story. And the people I connected with, Odette and her family, they lived in Sandy Bay. And that was mostly the area that I traveled to and mostly the people that I had met. But I know there are communities on the other side of the island as well. I'm hoping that this film will inspire Vincentians and the Carib and the Garifuna community there to pick up their own cameras and begin to tell more of their story.
Absolutely. And the reason I asked the question is because I do know why you did it, but you also, the film brings a different perspective to our history, which usually is spoken from the perspective of the African mixture, but very rarely has that connection been made with what the British used to call the yellow or red Caribs, which is what's really Sandy Bay, which is where Dr. Gill comes from.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, right.
Absolutely. The other question that I have, when you were there with the ballet in 2005, and actually, let me make this statement and you can follow up on it, that as I mentioned, with your two films, you have covered the history and also what's happening today, but you also have covered Belize and Honduras, which very few filmmakers or anthropologists have done. And I must commend you for that. How was it working with the ballet?
How is it working with who?
With the folkloric ballet from Honduras. Bringing the Honduran, you know, working with the Garifunas from Honduras. I know that the journey was mostly in Belize, but now you have the opportunity to work with the Honduran Garifuna. How was that?
I first met them when I was there in 2012, actually. That was Armando and Ashanti with the National Garifuna Ballet of Honduras. And, you know, it was a real honor. It's an honor for me to be able to work with Garifuna community. And I've been to Roatan, I've been to Guatemala, I've been to Belize, and here in the United States. You know, it's a real honor for me to do that. I would love to see more communication from, you know, the diaspora with St. Vincent itself, so because they're really in need of it. Did that come out in the film? Did your audience really see that need, that desire?
Well, that's a good segue to see if anybody in the audience has any questions for Andrea. She is the producer of the film. Any questions from the audience? Yes, sir. Okay, that's actually a question. That's a good segue. That's a question for the people right here in front of us, Mr. Celso Castro. The question was about the hospital. You heard it, right, Celso?
Yes. My name is Celso Castro, and I'm the president of Garifuna Health and Education Support Initiative in New York. We do work out of the Bronx. But prior to me answering your question, I would just like to commend Andrea for such a great work on documenting this historical piece, as well as also thank and commend Beth Giglia, as well as Mr. Jesse Friston for such a good work also with the revolutionary medicine documentation. Great job. It's really important to keep these kinds of activities rolling so that we can immortalize our people and the struggle of our people. But going to your question, how does the hospital sustain, what sustains the hospital? Actually, it is a community hospital. There is no government funding going into it. There is absolutely no link to the government per se, so that they can pass on some monies or medication to the hospital. So how do we sustain it? Several ways we do it. Our organization here in New York does fundraising. Not only that we do fundraising, we also do medicine drives. We just finished a medicine drive, I think about 3 months ago or so. We plan to have another one sometimes the first quarter of next year. I can go ahead and give you some, if we can get your email address, probably outside, we'll be able to more than happy to send you some information as activities do come up. The hospital gets medication from private donations. We do have also medical brigades coming to Honduras from the US, from Europe, as well as from Cuba, who essentially will bring also some of the medications to sustain the hospital. The other way that we get our medication is that Dr. Luther Castillo does quite a bit of talks and presentations outside the country. And some of the money that he makes for his presentations goes towards the hospital, goes towards purchasing medication to the hospital. In so many cases, sometimes an exchange type of activity where he will go ahead and present and talk about health issues, and in turn he gets medication as a donation to the hospital. So, but we like to make this effort even much more efficient by creating some system of getting more medication for sustainability.
Thank you, Cecil. Any other questions from the audience? Yes, ma'am. And Andrea, the question is for you. How did you become interested in the Garifunas?
Well, I was a student at the School of the Art Institute in Chicago, and I was a graduate student, and I wanted to look into artists and the layers of culture, African, Caribbean, and indigenous culture in the Caribbean. And I picked St. Vincent to go to. This was in 1981. In fact, my son, who was there, was with me on that trip.
While I was the son is right there.
Yeah, hi, Eli. So while I was there in St. Vincent, 1981, I had heard about a group of people who lived on the island on the north side of it. They were called the Caribs. I was told to stay away from them because they were, even at that time, they were called savages and, you know, unfriendly and cannibals, if I can use that word. I mean, it was unbelievable what they were saying to me. So, of course, I wanted to go there because I could not go there, of course. Well, at the time, they were not very open to talking to me or relating to me, which is really understandable because they've been so disenfranchised. So I came back to the United States after doing that research and publishing a paper and doing research at the library, Africana Library at Northwestern, looking at everything I could find on Caribs, Black Caribs. That was the only name I knew. But there was very little that was published up to that point. There's a few, you know, older papers or dissertations. But then in 1994, my partner at the time, Bob Richards, he was in Belize for Griffith Settlement Day. And he called me up and said, Andrea, you have to come down to Belize because I finally found the group of people that you've been talking about for the last decade. And that was 1994. It was Griffith Settlement Day in Dangriga, Belize, and Punta Gorda. Actually, it was in Punta Gorda. And so I came down and with the camera, and that was the beginning of our journey. Bob Richards was my co-producer on that particular, on the Garifuna right. journey. And that's how I got involved with the Garifuna.
Any other? Yes, ma'am. The question was, is the Kalinago from Dominica are considered separate or the same people? I guess I'll answer that, Andrea, and I'll say that, yes, we are the same people. You can answer to that.
Yeah, you know, I think what was distinct about the Garifuna community on St. Vincent is the mixture with the Africans, which is more dominant, but I don't know if it's dominant, but there was certainly more mixture. So, and the fact that, St. Vincent was known to be the center of resistance. And so it was those people 200 years ago that were exiled because of their resistance. I actually have not been to Dominica. Have you, Jose? Have you been to Dominica?
No, I haven't, but I do know that they're the same. And I guess and you're absolutely right. The difference is that the ones that were exiled were those of us who mixed with the Africans. Which became known as the Black Caribs. So, but we are the same, the mixture with the Caribs and the Arawak throughout the islands. There was a question in the back. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you so much. This is a wonderful program. Also, Caribs are indigenous to the Venezuela, Guyana, and Suriname, and French Guyana. The communities of Caribs are there too. But I'd like to
okay, the observation was that there are Caribs actually throughout South America. And yes, I will attest to that because according to history, of course, it's the Orinoco section of South America where the Caribs ended up in the Caribbean. And we do not tie that when we talk about the Garifuna history. And the follow-up question was in herbalism, and if there has been any efforts to document that. Are you aware of anything, Andrew?
Well, in fact, I don't know if you know Fidelis Nunez, who lives in Chicago. Fidelis?
Yes.
Well, her mother, Valentina, is an incredible midwife and herbalist. And I don't know of any documentation that has been done on that subject or the women, but I actually did go to Hopkins and videotape Valentina as she was preparing some of her herbal remedies and following her. But unfortunately, funding is so difficult for independent filmmakers. I couldn't find the funding to finish that film, but I mean, that would be a wonderful film if anybody there in the audience is.
And actually, I'm going to tie that and throw a question to Celso, because I do know that the hospital, one of the things that we're looking into is actually traditional Garifuna medicine.
Yes, it's interesting that we are bringing this point to light only because it's so much an integral part of the Garifuna life and history and what have you. As we move forward with all the work for the hospital, traditional medicine is one of those elements that we incorporated into the whole structure of the hospital as well. We are currently creating a program for exchange students to go to Honduras and back to the U.S. and any other foreign country, so that we can have a taste of the entire culture, that is to include traditional medicine, herbal type of medication, natural medicine, and also anything that has to do with spiritual medicine as well. So that is in the making right now. But we do have some the beginnings of that work already going on at the hospital.
That was a remarkable film, the Revolutionary Medicine. I really commend the filmmakers and the people who are, you know, participating in making that hospital happen. A remarkable film.
Absolutely. Ed, go ahead.
I just wanted to comment on your, directly to your question, you mentioned the women as the culture bearers and often involved in preservation of the knowledge of the traditional medicine. My name is Niasha Lang. I'm from Belize. I made another film, one of the films about burials in a culture called Ponte Sol. But while living in Belize, I had the opportunity to interact with traditional healers from Punta Gorda town in Belize, many of whom were women. And what I found was that